Hello everyone. We start with a new topic today, that is brakes and dynamometers. We are learning different machine elements. So under that, the next set of machine elements is this combination, brakes and dynamometers. They have got certain things common, so they are combined together as a topic. Even in the books you will find a topic called as brakes and dynamometers. Now what are brakes? All of you must be knowing brake as a general term which is used in case of any of the vehicles, let it be cycle or a car or whatever. So everybody knows that brake is a device which is used for stopping a moving object, basically a moving disc or rotary object or whichever object is having a motion. That motion, if you want to stop or reduce, then we are supposed to apply brake. That is known to everybody, just as a in a layman's language. We are now going to learn brakes from the technical angle to find out how they work, how they function, what are the various features that are involved, what is the technical reason behind its working. So before we start, just write down one or two lines about what is a brake. So I'll just dictate one or two lines, you can write down. Brake is a mechanical machine element, you can write down. Brake is a mechanical machine element which is used for absorbing power. Which is used for absorbing power from a rotary device. So as to reduce or stop its rotation. So that is, in brief, you can say what is the function of a brake. So many of the times the objects which are in rotating condition, if you want to slow down their speed or if you want to stop them, then you are supposed to apply a brake. That is a machine element called as a brake, which works on for this purpose. Now having seen this, let us see what are the different types of brakes. So we write types of brakes. Now under this, the main category is shoe brakes. Now shoe brake is, it looks like this. Suppose this is a disc which you want to stop. It is rotating and you want to absorb power from the disc. Then what we do is, we are applying a frictional force with the help of a shoe, so that shoe is shown. One example is like this. So this is a brake shoe. So this brake shoe is brought in contact with the rotary object, so that because of the friction between the two parts, the motion is reduced or stopped. Okay, so we are applying some kind of a frictional force by bringing the shoe in contact with the rotary object. Now this is a shoe brake, and whatever we are right now drawn, this is external shoe brake. External shoe brake. So similar to external shoe brake, this other type, that is, we are doing the same thing from inside, so that makes it internal shoe brake. Where similar thing is done. So now I'll draw a ring, that is a hollow part. And then from inside, the same kind of a shoe is applied from inside. So I'll draw something like this. Maybe it has got some hinge here. One more part here. So these are the brake shoes I have drawn, of a brake material. Brake material means a friction material. Right now the brake shoe is in contact with the outside part, that is a drum which is rotating. This drum was initially rotating. Once you bring the shoes in contact, because of friction, a braking torque is applied, and as a result it will slow down or stop. Now for doing this, maybe you will require some kind of a force. So that force is applied somewhere from here, by some method a force is applied, so that both these shoes, they are pushed away from each other and they are resting on the disc. And once the braking axis is over, you want the rotation to be back. In that case, you need some method to bring the shoes away from the disc. That means the contact you want to break, you want the rotary motion to continue. So the shoes should be separated from the ring. So for that purpose, some kind of a device, maybe like a spring is used here, so that because of spring, they will be brought again nearer to each other, and the contact between the ring and the shoe will be broken, and the rotary motion can again start. So that is the internal shoe brake that is shown. Here there is an external shoe brake, just a simple sketch is shown. There is a lever, etc., which I have not drawn, because this shoe is not just hanging in air. It must be in contact with some kind of a lever or something, so that this lever you are going to swing or do something, so that the pressure is applied on the drum. So this is a shoe brake, what we saw, external and internal. Then the other broad category is band brake. Band brakes. Now band brakes, again there are different types. Simple band brake. Now in this case, I'll first draw the drum where the rotary motion is present, and you want to stop this rotary motion. So for that, there is a band that is surrounding the drum like this, and then there is a lever . So to this lever, the band is fixed, and now we are going to operate it by some method. So one of the methods could be like this, where there is a fulcrum here, and when you apply a force here, hand force, then this end will be brought down. So as a result, you are going to apply a force from outside, because the drum is in contact with the belt now, and the frictional force that is created because of the gripping action of this particular band, you are going to get opposite torque, that is a braking torque, which will oppose the torque by which it is rotating, and as a result it will slow down or stop. So this is a simple band brake, where what we observe is one end of the band is fixed, this is not going to move, and the other end only is pulled down. So by pulling just one end, we are applying pressure. That happens in the case of a simple band brake. The other type is differential band brake, is similar, but there is slight difference. So there is a drum again, there is a rope again surrounding the drum, like this. There is a lever also there. Now in this case, maybe fulcrum is somewhere here. So as a result, what happens is, if this is the direction of rotation, now what is done is, we are going to pull it in such a way, say I am applying some force here. So as a result, this point will be moving more distance, this point will be going up. That means one end is, you can say it is relaxing, and the other end is stretching. So you are pulling one end, but you are releasing other end. So whatever is the difference between the two, that is going to be applied here. And then that difference is finally such that it is going to stretch the belt, something similar to what has happened here. Because it is stretched more and released less. Because this distance is more, it is stretched more. This distance is less, so it is stretched, it is released less. So the difference is, the net difference is stretching. So that is why it is called the differential band brake. And again, we are going to work how the principle on which all these things are happening. the derivation and such thing. But in the meantime, we are just learning what are the different types and how they function. So this is the belt, differential band break, where the effort is applied by hand in this direction, and as a result, because the difference in the two sides stretching, the break gets applied, and it is called the differential band break. The third type is two-way band break. Two-way band break. So here what you can see is I'll draw it here because it may not be seen. There are different designs. What I have drawn is not the only one. There could be different ways. So the belt is covered here like this. So the belt is perpendicular to the lever, and what is shown there is a lever. So what happens here is, when we are, say, moving this up by some force, then this is rotating like this, the lever is rotating upwards, and both the other sides of the levers, they are rotating in the same direction like this. So as a result, you will find both the ends, in this case, both the ends of the ropes, they are pulled. So whichever is the area of contact, you can see the rope is in contact from this to this. That means this much is the angle up to which the rope is in contact, or the band is in contact with the drum. So when you are pulling both the ends, like what was shown here earlier, there is going to be a pressure that is applied all over the circumference of the belt, of the drum, to which the band is in contact. So all over, wherever there is band, some kind of a pressure will be applied from, force will be applied from outside, and the frictional force of that is the one which is going to cause the opposite reaction, and that is going to stop the rotation of the drum. So suppose the drum is rotating like this, by applying this kind of a stretch on the band, you are going to stop this. So these are two-way band break. I have drawn it here. Two-way band break, the figure is drawn here, and this is how it works. So having seen the basic types of the breaks and the subtypes, so shoe break and band break, they are the main types. Under shoe break, external and internal shoe breaks, and under band breaks, simple band break, where only one end is stretched, differential band break, where one end is stretched but the other end is released, and the difference between the two is such that the net result is stretched, and that, because of that, the belt is again gripping the drum and applying breaking torque. Two-way band break, again something similar, but here both the ends of the band, they are pulled, and as a result, you are applying a force all over the circumference till the belt is in contact, and then the brake is applied. So these are the basic types of two types of brakes. Now we are going further and trying to understand how the brake is working, how it is absorbing power. Now whatever is the power that is available at the drum that we are supposed to absorb, how that happens, and how much amount of force you are supposed to apply in order to absorb a certain amount of power that is present here. So you will find that you are given, in the description you are given, that there is a drum, at this drum there is so and so power available, and the drum is rotating at so and so speed. So how are you going to stop it, by what amount of force you are going to apply on a lever so that this kind of a drum is going to stop. That is the kind of exercise which we are going to carry out, which we are going to learn as a result of our further exercise. So you can have a look at it, jot it down, and then we will start the next part. Okay, so now we see the force analysis for the first case what we are drawn, a external shoe brake. So let me draw the shoe brake here of external type. So this is a drum again. It is rotating about its center point like this. And then there is a drum with a shoe here. This shoe is fixed to a lever. The lever is drawn. I draw a lever like this. The lever drawn, and the shoe is here. I'll just give the name lever. This is shoe here. And this is drum. Let's say the drum is rotating in this direction. That means there is a torque, there is a speed here, there is some power here present, and because of that the drum is rotating and we want to stop this rotation of the drum. Now when the rotation of the drum will stop, that is what we have to see. So suppose you are given power and speed. So these are the given things. Then from the given information, you can find, first you have to find torque at the drum. So this you can say power is equal to 2 pi n t by 60. So you can find torque equal to how much newton meter, because p is given, n is given, only t is not given. So what is the torque available at the drum, that you can find out. Now if the torque is available of this much amount, what, when this drum will stop, it will stop if you apply opposite torque of the same amount. So that opposite torque is called as braking torque, equal to T braking torque, shown as TB. So you have to apply opposite torque equal to TB. So with this TB torque, if you apply in the opposite direction, says that TB is equal to T if T equal to TB. That means whatever torque you have found out, exactly same amount of torque if you apply in the opposite direction, then what will happen is the drum will stop. Now from where this torque will come? This torque will come, any torque is force into distance. So for getting a torque in this direction, you require a force in this direction. So that force will come from the frictional force here. So I am just showing the frictional force here. This is the force, I will show it by F. So F is a frictional force which should be present there. So that this frictional force, and let's say this is R is the radius. So braking torque will be given by force of friction into radius of the drum. So for a particular radius of the drum, you are supposed to apply certain amount of force, so that F into R will be able to create a braking torque which will be equal to what you need. So how much amount of force you have to apply, that is to be decided by whatever is available here. Now from where this frictional force will come? Now all of you know the simple theory for the friction which you must have learned earlier, that suppose this is an object. This object is of weight A, W. It is resting on some surface. So if you try to pull this object in one direction like this, then it will result into a frictional force in this direction. So this frictional force will be equal to how much? This frictional force that is created is related to the weight of the object and the friction here. So we know that it is equal to mu into W. So mu into W is a frictional force that will be applied in the opposite direction of motion. So here also what happens is, since it is rotating, drum is rotating in this direction, frictional force will be in this direction, that will be applied. But when it will be applied, the moment you are pressing the shoe downwards, this much amount of frictional force will be generated. So I will show that this is a force that is applied in the vertical direction. I will call it as R. So this R is a force which will be applied in the vertical direction, so that if the R is already written here, so maybe we will call some other name here. Suppose this force we call as F, then this will be mu F. So whatever is the force applied in this direction, mu into F will be applied in this direction, and that mu F into R is going to be the torque. Okay. Now from where this F will come? F will come from what you are applying here. So if I apply, for this end to come down, you have to shift this end up by hand force P. P is the effort applied by hand. So when you apply effort by hand, this end will come down depending on where is the fulcrum. And once this end comes down, this end will have some force. So that force into coefficient of friction by this principle. This force is like a weight. So because of the direction of rotation, it will have frictional force. So F will have mu F. Like this mu W, it will be mu F in this opposite direction. This is just convention, and this is the actual case. So mu F is what is going to be applied in the opposite direction, and then mu F into R will be the braking torque. Now for this to happen, we need to know where is the fulcrum. Now we are going to take three cases. That's why I have just drawn this figure up to this much. And now we can mark exactly in this line, somewhere here, point A. And we are taking a case where the fulcrum is here. I'll just maybe show here. Point A. Then certain distances you need. So this distance is already mentioned here as y, and then some distance you require here also, which is x. So now what are the forces that are acting on the lever? That we have to see. Now when you are applying P here, that will result into F. That is, F is applied on the drum by the shoe. So there will be opposite force, equal and opposite force F